Good morning. Sorry, we just want to make sure everybody out there could actually see the service too. If you are able, would you please stand?
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great, Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to fight. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship Your holy name. Lord, I'll worship Your holy name.
Good morning, everybody. Well, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we invite You into this place, into our presence. You are welcome for sure in this place. Jesus said in Matthew, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am with them." As we begin our time of worship, please help us to release our cares, anything that might hinder us from experiencing more of you during this service, Lord. We focus our hearts and our minds on you. You are worthy of our praise, Lord. We ask your blessings, healing, and protection on us all today, with special prayers for Charlotte and her family, Ralph Wilder and his family, Tom Maychek, Donna Rooney, Pastor Pamela's cousin, Patricia, who fell last night and is in the hospital today, Shane and her family, and of course, Craig and Renee Mason and their family. So many people are in need of you, Lord, need of your touch, need of your support, your comfort. We pray that you be with them. Now, please hear us as we each take this silent moment to lift up our concerns to you. We ask that you would open our ears so that we may hear your voice. Open our minds so that we may receive your wisdom. Open our spirits so that we may know your guidance and leadership. And open our hearts so we can receive your love. We're gathered to lift up your name and the name of your son, Jesus, the name that's above all and every name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Now, I'd like to introduce Mr. Tracy Walker here, who's going to be our point of contact as we move forward with our small group program we're hoping to kick off soon. So, Tracy.
Thank you, Don. A few weeks ago, Don started talking a little bit about a goal for 2023, and that's to start a small group ministry. And the idea behind this is not long-term small groups that get together and meet continuously for a long period of time, but rather breaking down into three or four groups where we focus on a particular interest or a particular something that we all want to participate in, and these will run somewhere around 6 to 8 weeks, roughly. It's not a hard and fast schedule, but we're going to kick off our first set. It's kind of a semester approach, and we're going to kick off the first set beginning March 1st. Now, in order to make sure that we're offering things that you would like to participate in, we're taking a brief survey. So back on the table in the back, you're going to find a pile of surveys. All you're required to do is two check marks and maybe one day of the week written out. That's all we need from you. And by signing these, and you don't even have to put your name on it, but by participating in this survey, what you're going to allow us to do is make sure that we offer the kind of program or the kind of small group that you would be interested in attending. So there are four choices, four groups, and there's a description of each group, and then there are a list of potential meeting times. And if you would be kind enough to look at the descriptions and pick up to two groups that you might be interested in, and then a time, a day and time that you feel like you could commit to, that's all we're asking from you this morning. And then we'll compile that information, and here in a week or so, we'll go ahead and we'll announce the first set of groups, and then we'll conduct the sign up for that. So we'd really like to have your input so that we make sure that what we're offering is what you would like to participate in. Good? Excellent.
Woo-hoo!
All right. So it is good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen? Amen indeed. If you are new to Ocoee Oaks, I welcome you. We welcome you. And if you're visiting with us online, we are so glad to have you with us. And we want to let you know that the Ocoee Oaks is an amazing and a loving church, and it's led by the Holy Spirit through the congregation. The Spirit of the Lord is moving at Ocoee Oaks, and we are excited to share this with you. So this morning, here are the main announcements for this morning, and you're going to see that on either side of the stage, we have two separate collections that are going. The first one, the one over here is for canned goods, and that is the annual Super Bowl drive to help restock the Christian Service Center right here in Ocoee. They work to feed many people in our community, and they are attacking the problem of food insecurity. And we'll be collecting those canned goods until Super Bowl Sunday, which is February 12th. The second collection that we have going is for personal care items, and those are for children and youth who are currently living at the United Methodist Church Children's Home in Enterprise, Florida. Now, our youth have gone to the children's home annually, except during the pandemic, and they work in the thrift store, and that particular trip is coming up at the end of the month. And when they leave for the children's home, they're going to collect up these donated care products, and they're going to take them with them. And so we are going to be collecting deodorant, body wash, shampoo, and conditioner until this Wednesday coming up, the 25th. And if you have any questions, please get a hold of Pastor Don. Coming up on this coming Saturday at 3 p.m., we will have the Celebration of Life, that service for Warren Chase, and that'll be held right here in the sanctuary, and all are welcome. And finally, we do love to eat, and next Sunday is our fifth Sunday Ocoee Oaks Family Potluck. It starts at 5 o'clock, and we just ask you to make it a point to come out and share a meal with your church family. And I have been assured that if you don't have a chance to make something, that's okay. Come anyway, because I understand that you are generous with the food, and I'm looking forward to that. Now, if you'll stand as you are able, and Wendy will lead us in our opening hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Will you join me now as we confess our faith? We'll first recite the Apostles' Creed. The words will be up on the screen. And then we will follow that with the Lord's Prayer, and those words will also be on the screen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Okay. Change in plans. We are not doing the Lord's Prayer this morning. But instead, if you will stand, if you will stand, we will join our voices now in praise, singing, "In Christ There Is No East or West," followed by "Who You Say I Am."
The highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Ooh, the His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me. Through the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. Oh, I am who You say I am. Through the sun sets free, always free indeed. I'm a child. There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Need to really listen to what you're saying.
Forsaken, I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me. Chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. Oh, I am who You say I am. Yes, I am who You say I am. Ooh, the sun sets free.
Our scripture this morning, which happens to be one of my personal favorites, comes from the book of Acts, and will be in chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. And this is a passage where Luke describes the early church. Hear now these words. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And now, as we prepare our hearts, Pastor Don will continue our sermon series on fellowship. And today, his message is titled, "We Are Gathering Here for Rhythm."
All right, good morning again. Good morning again. There we are. And don't worry, I'm not talking about rhythm. I'm not going to get up here and dance. You don't want to see that. No one really does. But yeah, he knows too well. So, all right, well, let's pray. May these words from my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, our Lord, our Rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. A few months ago, when we were doing the sermon series on blessings, during one of those messages, I covered this poem, and I think it's really fitting for us again today, so I'm going to read this to you again. It's titled, "Who Am I?" I am your constant companion, so I am your greatest help or your heaviest burden. I'll push you onward or I'll drag you down. I'm completely at your command. Half the things you do might as well be turned over to me, and I'll do them quickly and correctly. I'm easily managed. You must merely be firm with me. Show me exactly how you want something done, and after a few lessons, I'll start doing it automatically. I'm the servant of all great men and women, and alas, the failure of them as well. Those who are great, I have made great. Those who are failures, I have made them failures. I'm not a machine, though I work with the precision and repetition of a machine, plus the intelligence of a human. You may run me for profit or run me for ruin. It makes no difference to me. Take me, train me, be firm with me, and I'll place the world at your feet. Be easy with me, and I'll destroy you. Who am I? Anybody remember? A habit. Not a hobbit, but a habit. Exactly. A habit. Well, that's what we're going to be talking about today, habits and the rhythm of life. Welcome back for part two of our sermon series. We're gathered here today, this time for rhythm. As we get started today, I want to ask everybody to think about some habits that you have, some really strong habits that you do. You hardly have to think about it. It just happens in your life. Just for a moment, just try to come up with one or two. Could be putting salt on your food at the restaurant before you taste it, right? Something as simple as that. It could be driving slow in the left lane because you like to hear horns honk. Or maybe automatically, without thinking about it, saying, "God bless you," every time you hear someone sneeze somewhere. Whatever it is, we all have habits. I know many of you were probably thinking of some of the bad ones that you might have that you want to get rid of, and that's normal, but we have so many good habits too. Like the poem I read a minute ago, habits are powerful, good or bad, right or wrong, they're powerful. And they'll impact our life, good or bad. In fact, we know it's hard to shake off bad habits since it takes an average of, I was always told 21 days, but it's actually 66 days. The difference between that is it takes 66 days for a habit to be ingrained more in your mind so you no longer have to think about the habit. It's 21 days to get to the point where you're going through the motions of the habit, but 66 days now to get a habit instilled by doing it consistently day in, day out, to be part of what it does. So it becomes more automatic, so you don't have to think about it very much. You just have to maintain it nice and easy. With that little nugget of wisdom, let me offer you another one. Habits follow cravings or needs. Habits get their stay power from the rewards being reinforcing the behavior. I'm not going to get deep in that, so don't worry, I'm not going to lose you here. But there's a reason we have habits. There's a way we need to set ourselves up so that we can implement good habits and get rid of bad habits. We got to look at what's driving the habit. For instance, if you're smoking and you really want to stop smoking, if you don't address the craving for the smoking, then you're not going to have a lot of success. There, your body has that reward for smoking, and until you address that reward, the habit of smoking is going to be very difficult to get rid of. Similarly, if we want to start new habits, we also need to understand the underlying cravings and rewards that contribute to us building these new habits and helping them to impact our lives in positive ways. For instance, you want to build a habit to be in better shape. It's January, right? That's like 68% of New Year's resolutions that are already broken 3 weeks in. But to be in better shape this year. Well, if the reward that you're focusing on with this goal, getting into the habit of being in better shape, if your reward is, I want to be in better shape, I'm going to look better. Well, that's pretty superficial. And when it comes right down to it, the importance of you looking better or just because you want to be in shape might not be important enough, might not be as important as I really want this third piece of pizza today. You know, it's going to balance that. There's a reward there for behaviors, and the reward you want, your goal, the reward you want to build this habit around has to be strong enough to keep you firm in your focus. So let's say you change that, though. Instead of, I want to be in shape because I want to look better, I want to be in shape just for the sake of being in shape. Let's say you change something more meaningful. I want to be in shape and healthy because I want to increase the likelihood of spending more time with my grandchildren. If that's the reward you're focusing on, now that's a whole different level of rewarding, right? That gives you a whole different goal now. That's an important enough result or outcome that it'll be a little bit easier to get yourself out of bed in the morning to go on that walk instead of sleeping in. And the more you get yourself out of bed in the morning to go on that walk, the easier it will be the next day to do the same. And the next day, and the next day. And soon, after roughly 66 days, you won't be thinking about it. The alarm goes off. You hop out of bed, and you go forward with your walk. Because now you've created a positive habit that helps you move in the direction you want to go. Does that make sense? Do we crave God-honoring relationships with other believers? Do we desire to have a consistent and powerful prayer life? Do we really want a deeper understanding of the Word and the teachings of Jesus? And not just, yeah, we do, of course, but do we hunger for it? Is there enough emphasis there to keep us strong in these goals when so many other things vie for our time and our focus? Or is it easy to let this fall behind and take care of that? We can stay firm in our structure, firm in our focus, and to the point where we create a habit, it becomes much easier to stay strong in what we want to do. But again, are we hungering for these things? We know we're supposed to say yes, but what would our faith look like? What would your faith look like? Seriously, I'm not just asking, think about it for a second. What would your faith look like if you really craved fellowship, if you really craved communion, if you really craved prayer and worship? You just felt that need. You had to participate. You wanted to do it. It was important to you. Would our faith or our lives or our relationships with others or even with Christ, would it be different? What would it look like? How could a healthy rhythm of gathering in fellowship with other believers help us develop those habits of faith that we really want in our lives? The early church knew something about gathering together, so much so that churches have been modeling their behaviors and their focus for thousands of years, right? Earlier, Tracy just read a scripture about the Acts church. Acts 2, verse 42 highlights several things that they were specifically devoted to. They focused on every time they got together. Let's read it again. It said, "And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and fellowship, breaking bread, and prayers." Early church devoted themselves to teaching and therefore learning, right? Fellowship, gathering, and activities together. Breaking of bread, both communion and having meals together. And prayer. The scripture highlights these as the rewards. If you're willing to make time to go out and get together with fellow believers, your rewards are fellowship. It's prayer. It's learning more about Christ. Right? These are the rewards that help drive them. They knew that those things were important to them, and they wanted to make it happen. And they knew at that time, at least, fellowship, getting together in groups, was key. I want you to think for a second about something that you are absolutely committed to doing every day. Could be brushing your teeth in the morning a certain time. Whatever it is, just think about something that you do every day, almost, it's going to happen. And this is a kind of thing that unwavering devotion, consistent rhythm in your life can have a result in. It's because you committed at some point in your life, you decided you're going to do this, and this is when you're going to do it, and it's going to happen every day. Imagine if we took that same approach to our faith life. Teaching, fellowship, breaking bread, and prayer. I'm going to quickly cover each one of those. How many of you enjoy learning? There's a handful. I guess it depends on the topic, right? Well, learning scriptures together with other believers is something that the church, the early church, absolutely drove. It was so important to them. Learning takes time and it can be difficult. Learning requires effort and attention. But the reward, however, is a deeper understanding of what God wants of us, of what He needs us to be doing, of what we need to do to be more like Christ. And what a great reward. And the question is, are we focused enough on that reward to get this habit built where we're willing to learn? I'm not sure if any follower of Christ would ever say that they don't really want a deeper understanding of Scripture, faith, and ultimately God, right? Of course we all want it, but do we crave it enough to do this instead of that? That's the question. And to believe that we already know everything the Scriptures have to tell us, okay, we already know that, right? We're always learning more. We've got a couple Bible study groups that meet pretty much every day or every Sunday after church service. And even though some of them have been, you know, in Bible study groups for a very long time, just a while? They've been in study groups for a while. I guarantee you they're still learning. That group can be studying the same passage as someone's that they've been studying for, you know, a dozen times in the last 10 years. And yet there's something else that'll come out of the Scripture to them. They're always learning. We can never get to the point where we don't have more to learn from the scriptures. Number two is fellowship and gathering together. As I mentioned earlier from Acts chapter 2, verse 46, that early church was devoted to meeting together daily. Now, I'm not going to say that we need to get together in formal service. You know, we're going to start having, you know, 9 p.m. services every night, so y'all come out. I need to see you every day. That's not where we're going, but somehow, other than Sunday morning service, and I'm glad you're all here, whether here or watching the stream, whatever it is, I'm glad you're here, but you need more. You need to get together with other believers more often. There are a lot of different options, great ways. I mean, we've got Bible studies. Where you just heard we're getting ready with small groups. Always have things going on. Men's ministry breakfast was awesome yesterday. Women's ministry is getting together frequently. We've got a lot of things happening. Fifth Sunday potluck next week. A lot of great opportunities. But here's the thing, folks. This isn't high school and we're not a clique. Guess what? You don't have to get together just with your church family. Hopefully you've got a circle of friends outside of this church. Maybe they attend their own church. Whatever it is, that's fine. Get in a group of believers and spend time. Do Bible studies. Just be with them in a group of fellowship and with other believers. Doesn't have to be here. It really doesn't. We miss you. We want you here. But it doesn't have to be here. Just be with other believers. Not all the time. We're not saying that, but spend time with believers. Number three, breaking of bread, both communion and having meals. Now, we consider having meals fellowship. So it kind of goes in a different category, but I want to talk specifically about communion as the early church looked at it. Communion was incredibly important, and here's why the church was so stubbornly devoted to it. And this is from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 through 26. So tech room, if you want to pop that up on the screen for me. Of course, we're not going to skip the Lord's Prayer. But it worked really well right here in the message instead. So, I did it early. The Lord, this is actually part of communion. So 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 through 26. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." A little different verbiage than what we typically do during communion, and we'll be doing that soon. But again, please pay close attention to those words that we're saying. Communion is about remembering Jesus, his life, his sacrifice on the cross, his body broken for you and me, his blood shed for our sacrifice of our sins, and marking a new covenant between God and man. That's an incredible moment in history and in the life of us. His death, his resurrection, his promise to come back again for his church. These are the realities that believers, that we simply cannot forget. And he asked us to remember and do this frequently together. Because communion is implicitly done with others, it follows that we celebrate Jesus together. There are some churches that do communion just once a month. I'm not saying right or wrong, but what I'm saying is here at this church, we do it every week. We are committed to communion and doing it every week. So as long as we stay focused on what it means each time, then that is a beautiful, beautiful thing. Last category is prayer. Simply put, prayer is an exchange we make when we make our requests, our thanks, our adorations to God, and he receives them, right? We've done sermon series on prayer. We're not going to get deep into prayer. One thing I want to point out, though, is this. It's a gift to be able to pray with others in community. Some may be a little uncomfortable if they're asked to pray out loud in a group setting, but, you know, it's a gift. And we're not saying that it's not really important and it's not powerful to pray on your own, but communal prayer is so important in the spiritual life of believers. And now this is where the Lord's Prayer comes in mind. In fact, when he was asked to give advice on prayer, listen to what Jesus said, and I think it's going to be familiar to you. This is from Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 through 13. And again, you guys are used to saying it. We're not going to bow our heads this time and pray it. I want you to read it off the screen. You know the words, but I want you to see the words when you're saying it, all right? So let's say this together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. That prayer in the scriptures, Jesus introduced it by saying this. This, then, is how you should pray. And then he taught him that prayer. How many times would you guess you've probably said that prayer? It's going to vary from person to person, but for many of you, it's probably literally thousands of times, right? Doing the math, okay, at least 52 times a year, right? How many years? We've probably said that thousands of times. Well, how many of you have ever noticed the communal nature of that prayer? And by that, I mean, did you ever notice that Jesus doesn't instruct us to pray using personal pronouns? It doesn't say, my Father who art in heaven, give me this day my daily bread, forgive me of my sins, right? It doesn't say that. He uses plural pronouns like our and us and we. The most famous prayer of all time, the one that Jesus set up as the model for how we should pray, is a communal prayer. It's meant to be spoken out loud in the fellowship of others, or at least to be spoken thinking of others, thinking of yourself as part of a group, not you just yourself. And that's, of course, once again, individual prayer is incredibly important too. But the prayer Jesus taught us is about us being one with each other and doing this prayer together. As we wrap up today, I want to revisit something we talked about last week. The conclusion from last week's message went something like this. For all the benefits we receive in fellowship, it's deeper than that. We gather because it's who we are. When we have tough times speaking, when things don't go our way, when we're confused, frustrated, angry, sad, we gather with others in fellowship for encouragement. And we spur each other on towards love and good deeds because it's who we are as believers. It's who we are as a family in Christ. Now, this is true, of course, but there's also numerous other benefits we experience when we come together as a family, as a body of Christ. We talked today about the fact that we learn. We remember Jesus. We have fellowship. We pray together. Just to name a few of those, the early church was absolutely committed to these habits, and they needed to persevere through life and all its difficulties. And, you know, sometimes, you know, we can get caught up in our own stuff and say, oh my gosh, this is awful. Well, if you think about that first church, oh my gosh, the persecution they went through And they did these things to build habits. They did them daily. They did them every time they got together so that every time they got together, they would be sure to do these things, to build habits. They depended on this. And then the habits took life, and it just helped drive their spiritual faith, helped drive the strength of their belief so they could stay strong in the face of the type of persecution that they went through. Gave their faith the strength to persevere. So when they got to, so they got together, they learned, they remembered, they fellowshiped, and they prayed. Take me, train me, be firm with me, and I'll place the world at your feet. Be easy with me, and I'll destroy you. Are we being firm enough with ourselves to create good habits that'll help drive our faith forward? Are we making the most of this God-given gift that we call today habits to help us be strong, to help us persevere, to help us to be a little bit more like Christ every day? That's our goal, folks. Let's pray. Dear Lord, give us wisdom to identify habits that we'd like to change. Give us the strength to change them. Give us strength to be firm with ourselves so that we can create and enhance habits and a life rhythm that can help us grow in our life of faith, grow in our fellowship with each other, and all the while grow closer to you. Amen. We talked a moment ago. We kind of went through the early church and how they did communion and how important it was to them, and how here at this church we see the importance of communion and to do it every single Sunday. And here at the Ocoee Oaks, we do practice open communion, which means that everyone is welcome to take communion. You don't have to be part of this church or part of the Methodist church or any church at all to take communion here. We welcome you all. If you haven't yet got elements, they're passing them out in the back. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and of wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in the ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, he gave thanks, he broke the bread, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It's poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." All right. The body of Christ broken for us. The blood of Christ shed for us. All right, people, the altar is open. Please come as you feel called. Please stand if you're able and join us in our sing our closing song, Old Church Choir.
There's revival, and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it?
Amen. Those are some seriously great results we can look forward to for building good habits that drive our faith life, aren't they? All right. As you leave this place, may the living Lord go with you. May He go behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, beneath you to lift you up from your sorrows, within you to give you the gifts of faith, hope, and love, and always before you to show you the way. Amen and God bless.